Fantastic. If you want to turn to Philippians chapter 2, page 1114. Joe says, I may be tired, but I'm happy. Tired, but happy. It's just I'm an old man. I can't take my late nights like I used to. I'm only laughing to myself because I don't know if I should say this really, but my 18-year-old son, since he's finished his A-levels, he has been partying hard, let me tell you. I'm just amazed at the energy and the stamina he's got to keep going. I'm in awe. Philippians 2, from verse 1. Therefore, Paul writes, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same attitude of mind Christ Jesus had, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a human being, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Father, thank you so much for your word that waters a soul, that feeds a life, that challenges, informs, inspires. Thank you, Lord, that this scripture is God-breathed, is useful for teaching and correcting and rebuking and training in righteousness. Lord, we are those who this evening, we want to be trained in righteousness. We want to become spiritually fit. So speak to us this evening, equip us, train us. For Jesus' sake, amen. Well, for those of you new or visiting, or if you've been away for a couple of weeks, we're this little mini-series in the lead-up to focus our week away, which we're entitling Spiritual Fitness, kind of recognizing that, just acknowledging that we kind of live in a kind of gym culture, many of us here, I guess, me included. It's hundreds of pounds over the year that you pour into a gym membership in order to get ourselves physically fit, toned, healthy, whatever it might be, whatever our goals are. In such a way that it's kind of, you know, we notice. It's maybe housemates or workmates, they kind of notice, you know, hey, you've been working out, you're looking good. And the goal really here is that the same might be said of people as they look, in a sense, a little bit harder or with a little bit more discernment at the way in which we live our lives, the way in which we are. Have you been, as it were, working out, thinking about virtues, old-fashioned virtues, time-honored virtues, character, about inner fitness, strength, will, that we look, as one of our numbers said at the start of this series, that we would be spiritually ripped, the equivalent of a spiritual six-pack or whatever it might be, that we're looking to develop. And the kind of undergirding principle for all of this is that we don't try to be like Jesus, because we will basically fail. It's a subtle little one of the enemy. He whispers and says, why don't you try to be like Jesus? Try to be like, that's the game, try to be like Jesus. When we try, we fail. And then we become despondent and lose heart. It's not about trying to be like Jesus. It's about training to be like Jesus. Paul said to Timothy, we looked at it a couple of weeks ago, train yourself to be godly. And with little, we saw that first week, indirect effort, indirect steps, little ways in which we can train ourselves to become like Jesus. Don't try to be like Jesus, train to be like Jesus. And we're looking at various different training techniques, if you like, practices or disciplines, which maybe sounds a bit negative, but these are opportunities for us to become spiritually honed. And today I want to look at the discipline, the practice of service in a self-obsessed world. Service in a self-obsessed world. And just by way of introduction, you know, you can, in order to get yourself fit in general, you can focus on the things that will make you stronger and fitter and healthier. And at the same time, for overall health, you can look at those things that are inhibiting your strength or fitness. It may be other things, your diet or your lifestyle, how much rest you're getting. What are the things that are undermining your attempt to be fit and healthy and strong? And I want this evening to begin by way of a sort of lead into service, to maybe look at some of the things that perhaps we just don't notice in the culture in which we live that are undermining our ability to be spiritually honed. It's just really to look at some of the changes that have happened in the last 200 years, in the last 50 years, in the last 20 years, the changes that are happening even now that will impact, and inevitably they are impacting us and have impacted us. Over the last 200 years, and they impact us in terms of our ability to relate to one another, which impacts our spirituality, impacts who we are and how we are. So in the last 200 years, our social mobility has increased out of all recognition. You know, 200 years ago or so, and all the time before that, in all likelihood, the place where you were born was the place where you'd have been educated and the place where you'd have grown up, got a job, and lived with others in your community who had exactly the same experience. The chances are, let's think of a mining community in South Wales or a factory in the Midlands, the chances are the person you were at primary school with is the person you started the factory floor with, the person you retired with. Communities knew each other. In the east end of London, in the sort of start of last century, you know, in just a line of terrace houses, and mums would just throw their kids out onto the street, and they just knew that everyone would be looking out for everyone else. They could have a great game of football or whatever it was, and mum could get on with whatever. And they kind of just knew that Mrs. Hodgkins would, if she needed to, you know, deliver a thick ear to whoever it was, whichever kid it was, that would happen, and that was just, it was just how it worked. Everyone knew everyone. It'd be really interesting to do a straw poll on us today. What's the longest friendship that we've had? I mean, is anyone still even in touch with people that you went to primary school with? Or to just look at your workstation, and now down into sort of the last 50 years, the mobility within the workplace. Your sort of grandfather, great-grandfather's generation, let's say, probably, there were a lot of people who had a job for life. You were apprenticed, and you worked your way up, and you just worked at the same company or the same organization, pretty much. Very rare these days. People are, your sort of workplace is so much more fluid. So I wonder how many of you have had work colleagues for more than 5 years in the same place, or you know, others have been working around. Just the flow. And all of this add into technology in the last 10 years, technological transformation, has impacted the way in which we relate. It's made it harder for us to create and sustain meaningful friendships, relationships. I remember growing up and going into the nearest village. That makes me sound like I'm a sort of rural boy. I was in suburbia, but there was a kind of, I grew up in Beckenham, in sort of Kent. It's a London postcode, you know, sort of southeast London. But we lived in between Bromley and Beckenham, which is, and Shortlands, with this little sort of, it was like a little village. Kind of had a high street and shops and so on. And that's where we would go. And I can remember going with Mum down to the bank. And the only way, dates me now, but the only way you could get money was by going into the bank and cashing a check. Didn't have a card or hole in the wall or anything like that. And I can remember Mum going up to the cashier and being greeted by name. cashier knew who she was, because you go in regularly to draw cash. And the cashier knew who the people said, hello, Mrs. Stillwell. And we went out, having engaged with someone with cash in hand, and we went to Sammy's. And Sammy's was two doors down, and Sammy's was the local grocer, owned by a guy called Sammy. Guess who served us most days when we went into the Sammy who owned the shop? Sammy's shop was owned by Sammy, and Sammy served us. And we knew Sammy, and Sammy knew us. And all the families around who shop there regularly. I think I do the equivalent today of getting some money and doing some shopping. And I can so easily do that today without talking to a single person. I go to the hole in the wall down there, and then I go into Waitrose and I get all the stuff. And if the green light's flashing on the automated till, and I know last week I was sort of weighing it all up, but I go to the till and I can just scan it myself, beep, 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 and out I go without one single human engagement. Now, that in one sense is, I'm sort of it's a kind of trite example, but extrapolate that in terms of the lives that we lead today. Robert Putnam wrote a kind of seminal book at the turn of the century, about 15 years ago in America. It was called Bowling Alone, subtitled The Collapse of Community in the United States of America. Bowling Alone, this idea that whereas that was once thought of as a great social thing, party thing, and in a sense it still is, but now he used it as a metaphor for life. But whereas, let's take a London example. We get on the tube, we commute to work, and yesteryear, I know you don't talk on the tube, but at least you were kind of aware of people. But now we have the ears in. Now we have the smartphones. Just as a little exercise, to verify whether I'm speaking sense or not, tomorrow, those of you who commute on the tube, just take your ears out, put your phone away from it, and have a look around, and see if you can get eye contact with anyone else. See if anyone's up for some kind of a non-verbal rapport. And I know that sounds really unusual now, but it was much more likely to happen 10 years ago. You wouldn't necessarily talk. We don't talk on the tube. But there was a kind of subconscious acknowledgement. And Putnam, in his book, he describes bowling alone. The atomization of community. He calls it the collapse of community. And what to do to revive community. And we're part of a community. We're relational beings. We're made by the Trinitarian God. We cannot help but relate. What is living in 21st century London doing to us if we're not paying attention? And what's it doing to our spirit, to our heart, to our core? I put it to you that whether we're conscious of it or not, we're living amongst, and maybe prone to, relational independence. Relational independence. And that is the seedbed for a preoccupation with self. I can't help noticing on TV that Facebook are advertising. Struck by that, I thought it just had a sort of organic reach and growth. But it seems there's a need now to advertise for the fact that you might need friends. Click. I thought this was interesting. I did a little sort of self-inventory, and what I'm about to say next is a confession, it's not a boast. I realize I'm on Facebook, and I realize that I had over 800 friends. I should just stop and think about that for a moment. I don't know how many friends you have. But if we just, for a moment, I'm not dissing Facebook. I'm not going to leave Facebook. It's a useful tool in many ways. 800 friends? I get little pop-ups, it's so-and-so's birthday today. And I go, oh, great, happy. It's a boot. Preoccupation with self. When I think about how I use Facebook, and I don't think about it, I'm conscious. What's that about, really? Is there not an element of the promotion of self? click, look what I've just done, click, look where I've just been, post, 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 look at me. Actually, let's take something quaint, like a photo album, like a paper copy, a proper with a hard cover and pages photo album, not the virtual electronic kind. We've got some photo albums gathering dust in the house next door, and what seems to be, you sort of leaf through the photo albums, is that in the majority of those pictures, I'm not there, I'm not in them. And that's because the majority of pictures I took with a camera that you couldn't make calls on, had a lens and things. I'm behind the lens, that's why I'm not in the pictures. But have you noticed today, I mean, I'm just going to say one word and you all know exactly what I mean. In fact, you predict the word. What is it? There it is. Finger on the pulse, you guys. Selfie. And what's that about? We go to India and we take a picture of the Taj Mahal, but somehow the Taj Mahal is not complete without me in it. I haven't verified this, but I promise it's true. I delivered this talk this morning, and at the 8 o'clock, and there's a guy at the 8 o'clock who's very well read. He just keeps up with current affairs and so on. And he told me that apparently the government in India have paid to increase the capacity of the Wi-Fi around the Taj Mahal. And I gave the example so that you can download your selfie on Facebook there and then. He said it's worse than you think, Tim. Preoccupation with self. Is it the endemic? Is it the disease of our time? So how are we to live spiritually fit lives within this context? Just maybe if we can get to the cause, if we can understand where this comes from, then we can root out that which is leading to our lack of fitness, and that will enable us to become strong. And the preoccupation with self, it's illustrated through the fall in Genesis 3. It goes right back. It's been there pretty much all along. When God creates, you know the story, he creates this paradise for Adam and Eve. But one of the very first questions that God asks Adam and Eve is, where are you? It's a chilling question. Where are you? This is the God of relationship, the God of intimacy, the God who created man and woman, Adam and Eve, in his image in order to share relationship. And they're hiding. Second question that God asks after the where are you question is the what have you done? And the answer to that question is they've eaten of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. God forbade them to eat. But the enemy, the serpent, has tempted them. And what's he tempted them with? It's the oldest sin in the book. And it's the root cause of our loneliness, ironically. Pride. The serpent says to Adam and Eve, and you can check it out in chapter 3 of Genesis. The serpent says to Adam and Eve, well, when God says, don't eat, of course you can eat. Because, and you see it in Scripture, then you will be like God. And he just tickles that deep, deep temptation to pride. Then you will be like God. Oh, that's good. I'll have some of that. And their eyes are opened. And part of the recognition is that they disobeyed God. And they hide. Where are you? What have you done? They've given in to the sin of pride. And the consequence of giving in to human pride, ultimately and ironically, is loneliness, is relational independence, is separation. And we see it played out in just a few chapters later, Genesis 11, having been banished from the beauty of the garden, men and women get together and look to create a city for themselves. Genesis 11, and the Tower of Babel. Let's make a tower for ourselves that reaches to the heavens. We'll be like God. We can reach God. We are God. The ultimate expression of human pride. And God comes and scatters the temple, the tower, and scatters the people and confuses their languages. Because pride running rampant will separate those that he's made from himself. you see pride popping up all over the place, independence, and it leads to despair, to loneliness. If that's a diagnosis, what's the antidote? And the antidote to pride is humility. Humility, not a false humility that is pretending to be something that you're not. Don't fall for that one. If you are a fantastic, as we've seen this last week, if you are a talented artist or an incredible musician, or you're brilliant at organizing things, or you have a creative eye, or you're so good with people, whatever it is that God has gifted you with, then live in it. Rejoice in it. Train in it. Get better at it. Don't be falsely humble about it. Humility is in full recognition of who we are. Humility is recognizing that the world does not revolve around us. Humility is to acknowledge that we are not the center of the universe, the center of the world, the center of all that's around us. That's where humility begins to kick in. And service releases humility. Practicing servanthood releases humility and undermines pride. And service in secret is like a catalyst to that. Service in secret, nothing like it but undoing pride and releasing humility and drawing us closer to God, making us stronger, fitter, leaner as spiritual human beings. Service connects us to the God who serves us. It kind of puts us into his trade wind, as it were, into his slipstream. Service connects us with others as we take our eyes off self and focus on others. And so as relational beings, we're satisfied, we're fulfilled. Service is what we were created for, so that we would become spiritually fit. Now let's look at this in Philippians 2 and say, well, how do I serve? And Paul says, the second half of verse 3, in humility value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. And in your relationships with one another, have the same attitude of mind Christ Jesus had, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. He didn't think that the world revolved around him, even though, as we sang earlier, his hands flung stars into space. He was there at creation. If anyone had the right to think that they were at the center of the universe, it's Jesus. And yet we're here. He didn't consider equality with God something to be used for his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a human being, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. It's interesting, the commentators just trying to unpick the word there, verse 6, who being in very nature God. Jesus being God. What kind of participle is that? Is it a concessive participle? In other words, Jesus, despite being God, he's God, but there's nothing he can do about that. He becomes a human being. Or is it causal? In other words, Jesus, precisely because he was God, became a human being. I know this sounds like sort of linguistic semantics, but just bear with me a moment. Perhaps if I can try and illustrate it. I could say, being a Fulham fan, I hope that we get promoted next season. And that's kind of concessive. It's despite the fact that I'm a Fulham fan, because frankly there's hardly any hope we'll get promoted. We're going to stave off relegation yet again, probably. I'm going to put up with the fact that, because I'm a Fulham fan. But if, just supposing, I was a Chelsea fan, and I said, being a Chelsea fan, I hope we win the league. Well, that's different. They're already the champions. They've got one of the best managers in the whole of Europe, if not the world. They've got an incredible squad and money behind it. That's causal. It's because I'm a Chelsea fan. I am confident we'll win the league. Do you see the difference? And commentators are divided on, well, which is it here, with being in very nature God. And I'm on the side of those, the second, the causal. It's because Jesus was God that he humbled himself. It's because Jesus was God that he came in the form of a servant. When Jesus clothed himself, as it were, in flesh and blood, it wasn't to disguise the fact that he was God. It was to reveal that he was God. It was to show us in ways that we would understand what God is like. God as server. Mark 10. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. When we sing and declare and pray and sign up to be followers of Jesus, we're following a servant. God calls us into relationship with him, to be like him, to grow in his likeness, for his life to grow in us. Not, and in so doing, to take on the life, the attitude, the habits, the practices of a servant. Not primarily because people need serving. God calls us to take on a life of service primarily because of what happens in us when we serve others. We become transformed into his likeness because his likeness is to serve. So when we train ourselves, when you go to the gym and you do a set of exercises, you'd expect over time to see a difference in your body. So when we practice, when we train in acts of service, we will see a difference in the way in which we live and in the kind of people that we are. And it's kind of costly and painful. Spiritual disciplines are, but so is going to the gym. If you take it seriously, I obviously with this next example, I can't reveal the identity of the person I'm talking about, but I have a colleague, this colleague, and I can't tell you who it is, obviously, but occasionally they like to go to the gym. And the other day, I was talking to Pat, and he was kind of going like this, his shoulder. I said, "Are you all right, mate? You okay?" He said, "Yeah, I went to the gym last night, and I think I may have slightly overdone it." And he'd been lifting, goodness knows, massive weights. I, you know, just look at the man. And and physiologically, I'm married to a physio, so I know muscle. This is how muscles work. When you exercise a muscle, actually, a microscope, you're actually tearing the fibers. You tear muscle fibers, and what makes muscles grow is the repair process, the mending process. And they get back together, and the repairing process is what builds muscle, makes it stronger, more efficient, more effective. But there's damage involved, there's cost. You break up what you currently are in order to grow what you want to become. So there's going to be a cost, there's going to be a tearing up process to the way in which we look to live our lives. Something in our worldview, our attitude, our mindset is going to need to be in order that we can accommodate the life of Jesus and allow him to grow in us. It's costly, but it's good. The life of service, when practiced on a regular basis, releases joy. It's counterintuitive. You won't hear that out there. Nothing in the world, in our consumerist societies, if you want to be happy, you need to consume, you need to acquire, you need to sort of hold on to stuff. No, actually, if we turn it around, we focus out, if we actually give away of ourselves, we expend ourselves, our time, our energy, when we invest it in others, not in ourselves, that is the source of true joy. And joy, a fruit of the Spirit, when that grows in us, makes us spiritually fit and healthy. You kind of know this, don't you? A little while ago, my son Luke and I, we went to wash our car. It's parked on the kind of driveway. and a friend's car was parked next to it. And so we went to wash our car, and as we were sort of washing the car, this was a few years ago, Luke was a little bit younger, and we were just kind of washing away, and I said, why don't I do the bits you can't reach? You do the kind of wheels and that kind of thing, we'll do teamwork. And we were washing the car, and he said, Dad, is that good enough? Will that do enough? Well, it's a little bit. And you could tell there's a sort of, when is this over type thing. Come on. And we watched the car, I said, great, great job. I said, mate, she was called Emma. Emma's car, I said, we've got the bucket and wood, why don't we wash Emma's car? Now, we'd only set out to wash our car. It's kind of a chore. Car needs washing. Got to wash the car. We're doing exactly the same work. We were washing a car. It's exactly the same thing. But somehow, doing it for someone else, he happily washed the whole car. Didn't ask a single question. It just released something in us. It was just fun. It was joyful to do something for someone else. And you kind of know that. When you've been part of a volunteer team or something, just these tidy things. I know you're good people. You do these kind of things. Kind of tidying up your own garden or tidying up your own house. Oh, what a fag. But when you do it for someone else, there's a kind of joy that's released. Exactly the same mundane chore. But something's released in us when we do something for someone else. True service, altruistic service, it releases joy. And it releases freedom. Second, that wonderful collect, Almighty God, whose service is perfect freedom. And you read that and you think, is that a misprint? That can't be right. Service, freedom. But you see, what we're doing when we turn our attention off ourselves is actually we're letting go of a weight that we were never designed to bear. The person who is created and is there yesterday, today, and forever to look after us is God, our Father. He's the one who sustains us. He's the one who gives us security and significance. He's the one who whispers assurances of our self-worth, how beautiful we are. If you ever doubt it, then look at what it costs for you to know him. That's what he did. You don't feel valuable. You don't feel sought after. You don't feel worth anything. Think of what it cost God to call you by name. He looks after you so that you're free to look out for others. You don't have to bear the weight of looking after yourself as well. The kind of paranoia around the kind of Twitter sphere and Facebook and how many likes have I got? Just step back and if needs be, have a fast. That's another spiritual discipline. Just this thing is beginning to consume my mind. Get away. Put it down. Give me space so that I can think, pray, look out for others. It's a freedom that comes. I was talking to someone the other day, they had Facebook on their phone, they took it off their phone. They're still on Facebook, when they had a keypad or computer, but just not to have that incessant bing, you got another notification. Bing, someone else's birthday, you don't even know who they are. Freedom. Just not to think of self, but to invest in others. What we're created to do is by doing that we slipstream God. Life just seems it's easier, it's slicker, it's more satisfying. It brings joy, it brings freedom. And can I just to say, this isn't a talk on relationships, but it brings a beauty. So often we go to the gym or we go to the clothes store, we go to the buy our sort of smellies and all that kind of stuff. We want to present ourselves as, beautiful and radiant for anyone who might be interested. Can I tell you an aroma that outlasts all of it? When the clothes have faded and the aroma wears off, it is that deep, deep aroma of Christ that you can do nothing about. It just pervades out of you when your mindset is to serve. Some of the most attractive people I know, I can think of one person who I know because they told me that they don't think by the world's human physical standards that they are particularly attractive. They don't fit the mold. And this person wrote an email to Joe and I, and we pinged right back and said, you are beautiful. Because we've got to know you and we know your heart, and your heart is to serve. And we've seen that, and it's beautiful. Don't swallow the lie that because you're not a certain dress size or whatever it is, that you're not. And when our hearts line up with God's heart, who is beautiful, and when we serve like he served, and when we think of others and invest in others, The payback is we know joy, we know freedom, we become beautiful, radiant, appealing. So here's the challenge for us as we go from here, is how are we going to practice acts of service? Now, I hope you've kind of, as I've been speaking, you're sort of ahead of me. And for those of you who think, this is, I could do with just setting aside some time, a bit of a sort of service workout. And you'd be racing ahead, you'd be doing your own things and just engaging with the Lord through the Spirit, ways in which you can practice service. We offer opportunities here as a church. And the collective noun for opportunities to practice service is rota. No, I'm joking. Let me say this. Please hear this. This is not a drive to recruit people to do all sorts of stuff. I live sometimes in fear that the words of Jesus were, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest." And we kind of turn it around as a church. You could come to me, all of you who are actually quite restful, and we'll give you a heavy burden. I live in fear that that's what we do with some people. So this is not a recruitment driver. But all I'm saying is that sometimes maybe we can all of us transform the thought of being on a rota, of helping out in some way, as not something that's got to be done, but an opportunity to practice service, an opportunity to release joy and freedom, to become appealing, an opportunity for me not just to connect with God and his people, but to connect with others on a team in some way. I can't think of anything that we invite people to do that you do on your own. Because even Andrew on the back on the AV desk, he's part of the worship team, and he comes in to pray, and they here couldn't do that without him back there. He's part of all of us. Even I think of the flower team or the hospitality team or just setting up when we set up the church, whatever it is, we're doing it with others. We're seeing others. We're serving with others. We're encouraging the life of Christ in others. So it's a training opportunity. Did I get away with that? out of the church. Because honestly, I know life is not just about the church. When we're the church scattered, when you're in your place of work or at home, how about this? I throw it out. In a week, there's 168 hours. Okay, you sleep for a number of them. But for the rest of the time, can you find in your week half an hour, where you lay down any agenda, you put away your to-do list, you switch off any kind of distraction, and you make yourself available for others in whatever way? Now, it might be at home with your housemates. You're in the house, everyone's around. I'm available to help, to serve in whatever way. How can I help? What can I do? And just for half an hour. Actually, we just within that half hour, pay attention to what's going on inside. I tried this. And I was horrified at how quickly I wanted to turn it back into an agenda that served me. Well, while I'm waiting, I'll just do this. I'll just do that. Of course, I dress it up as something virtuous. You know, I'm just going to do something that helps. Nah, it's actually all about me. Can you set aside just a parcel of time on a regular basis where you are only thinking of others? Service. Or maybe it's as a group. And again, as within the context of this church, as life groups or prayer triplets, or it's a friendship thing. And I love the fact that there are groups that are saying, you know, we'd like to do this. We'd like to serve in this way. We'd like to go here. We'd like to invest in this. Be it, you know, some other organization or something in the community that's going on. We want to give. We don't just want to gather and receive. Because we recognize that in giving, it's how we receive. When we lay down our lives, that's when we find them, Jesus says. So maybe as the corporate disciplines, you know, groups, we can wrestle with that one. I was talking to someone the other day, and they said, yeah, I'm not part of a life group, because I don't get much out of them. And I thought, gosh, you've just told me more than I think you intended to tell me in that one statement. Because it's as we give that we line up with the life of Jesus in whatever way. Being part of a group, being part of this church, is not all about you or me. It's as individuals come and recognize it's about us. And we practice that as a church. And then we go out and display it and live it in a world that is so desperate to be spiritually fit and spiritually honed. They have spirits, they're just atrophying. And we are the ones who will live fit, honed lives through our acts of service that will lead others to come and worship the one true living God. Amen. Amen. Let's just pause for a moment as we're sat here. Perhaps the band can come back, but just in this silence, this stillness. An opportunity for us to digest. And just to become aware maybe of the Spirit speaking to us in maybe a couple of ways. I mean, specifically, I'm sure, to each of us, but under two broad headings. One, maybe as a diagnosis to our flabbiness in this area. And it may be just as I've mentioned, the sin of pride, which masquerades in so many different forms. As I was speaking, as the Spirit was engaging with you, you recognized you wouldn't have called it pride, but now I come to think of it, yeah. That sort of independence, that self-sufficiency, that distancing from God and from others. As well, this is my life, thank you very much. That inhibits the ability to reach to others, that inhibits the desire to serve. Maybe it's a misunderstanding of humility. Doesn't mean you're not good at things. You can be brilliant at things and humble. It's just, you're not at the center of the world. God is. And he's got you so that you can reach out to others. That's humility. Or maybe positively, the other category is just practical ways in which we can kind of discipline ourselves, train ourselves to serve, giving out our lives for the sake of others so that God looks good in us. Final challenge, I'm going to lay it out now, and just for us to be thinking about as we are going to worship again, and just space to pray, to receive, to hear. But before you leave tonight, if the Lord has just pinpointed one thing you're going to do, this is what I'm going to do as a result of tonight, this is how I'm going to train in the whole area of servanthood, to tell one other person, and maybe set a deadline. Focus might be quite a good one, the end of July. Kind of just mark who it is and then report back in, 4 weeks' time. This is what I'm going to do to shift what I do in terms of service. And report back in 4 weeks' time. How's it gone? You don't have to do that, but I'd encourage you. There's an opportunity just to, we can train with one another. You know, in the gym, you kind of have people spotting for you and buddies who help you. That's what we're about here in this gym. So just as we are engaging with the Spirit and with all that he's feeding and teaching us today, why don't we stand together? We're going to worship God as the band lead us. Yeah, sorry.